So good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to the Clearwater Jazz Holiday Foundation's Young Lions Jazz Master Virtual Sessions. I'm going to be your guest host today. My name is Michael Kernodle, and our today's educator is going to be John O'Leary, and his topic is What I Love About Earl Hines, the legendary Earl Hines. I love it. This is part of our What I Love About series. So hopefully you're going to enjoy this today. I know John is not a visitor here. He's always here with Clearwater Jazz, and we love having him here. So just a reminder, when you come in, all the participants are going to be muted. And if you have any questions at all, please enter it in the chat. We would love some great interaction today. Whether you're a student, whether you're an expert, we would love to have your feedback. So you can also use the raise your hand option if you have any questions, and we'll ask the questions before the end of the session. We hope you enjoyed today's sessions. There's more upcoming free sessions. We'll be posted at www.clearwaterjazz.com/education/. And your feedback and any future sessions is really welcome. So you can email us here at info@clearwaterjazz.com. And before we start, we want to thank our sponsors. Also be sure to check out the studio archive of past video sessions at clearwaterjazz.com, education and outreach section. This is brought to you by Blue Water Wealth Management at Stewart Partners and Duke Energy, as well as our Young Lions podcast available wherever you stream. That's brought to you by our friends at Marine Max Clearwater. You can search Young Lions Jazz Virtual Sessions as well. So I want to give a little bit of this bio. Of course, it is a huge bio that we have here with John. And just some of the sessions that we've had here. I'm going to read out a couple, how to develop a language for improvisation on piano. I know that was awesome. How to develop rhythmic ideas to improvise better. How to create melodic lines for improvisation. How to use block chords. And he also had a session called What I Love About Oscar Peterson. He's one of my favorites. Also, What I Love About Bill Evans, Brad Maldu, and the list goes on and on. Now, just a little bit about John. He's part of this awesome, awesome group. I'm pretty sure you've heard of them. It's La Lucha. We love them here, not just here in Tampa Bay, but you know, they're known worldwide. But a little bit about more about John. John is a Mexican-American jazz pianist and neuroscientist. How did you get both of those? I don't know. He's a pianist for the highly acclaimed trio La Lucha in the Tampa Bay area. John has had a winding path. He is from the Yucatan Peninsula, where he started piano lessons at the age of 3 and played classical piano until the age of 12. Once in the U.S., he picked up the tuba in the concert band and continued to develop his musicianship through high school. Tuba, interesting instrument. I love that too. Later, he gravitated towards the piano, scoring accolades on both instruments. Now, John attended the University of South Florida, where he studied tuba, jazz piano, and biochemistry. I think we have a USF bull here. All right, he graduated cum laude with a BA in jazz piano performance, a minor in tuba performance, and honors thesis in biochemistry. John toured Italy and France with the USF Big Band and Jazz Tech Combo, playing in the 2007 Umbria Jazz Festival and Juan Les Pins Jazz Festival. As a member of these bands, he has played with many jazz greats, including Randy Brecker and Wyclef Gordon. I love it. As a scientist, John completed his PhD in neuroscience at the University of South Florida, where he is a recipient of the Ruth L. Kirstein Pre-Doctoral Fellowship from the National Institute of Neurological Disease and Stroke. John has been an invited speaker at the Society of Neuroscience, Midwestern Stress Response, and American Chemical Society conferences. Check out LaLucha's music wherever you stream. You can check them out. Their latest release, and it is amazing. It's called Everybody Wants to Rule the World. This is a very true statement. So, John, we are excited today. Go ahead and take it away, please.
Thank you so much for that, Michael. Really appreciate it. It's really an honor to be here. Every time I have the opportunity to be here in front of you, it's a huge honor. And today we'll be talking about Earl Father Hines. It's been an incredible journey learning about Earl and his incredible accomplishments, and what a wonderful musician he was, and the enormous part that he takes in the history of jazz music, of our true American art form. So let me go ahead and share this screen. I have to wait for the controls to disappear so I can play. There we go. Excellent. So what I love about Earl Father Hines, you can see he is very animated in this picture. One of the biggest discoveries that I made about Earl was that he bridges the gap between the old school and the new school, between the old guys like UB Blake, James P. Johnson, and those guys, and then the new guys, which are Dizzy Gillespie, Charlie Barker. How he functioned in that way, in between those spaces, between Louis Armstrong, then the swing era, and then after the swing era, the bebop era, and it's incredible how he was a part of each and every one of those phases, early jazz, swing era, and bebop, and how he was absolutely critical for the development of the music that we call jazz today. Without him, we might not have it. Okay, so Earl Hines was born in Duquesne, Pennsylvania. It's about 12 miles from the center of Pittsburgh on December 28, 1903. He would be very old today, over 100 years old. That's incredible. His father played the cornet and his stepmother was an organist. However, he tried to play the cornet, but it hurt to play. He had like pain behind his ears or something. And so he took piano lessons instead. And then he played in his church, and he played in his town, and he played in and out of Pittsburgh. As a kid, you know, growing up, he played in the Baptist church, and he was doing his thing. This quote here says, "My father was a cornet player, and I wanted to play that instrument when I was growing up, but playing it hurt me behind my ears. So I learned the piano instead, and I started playing on the piano what I wanted to play on the cornet." Now, Earl Hines has a style of playing the piano that is known as the trumpet style of piano. And it came from this idea that he wanted to play on the piano what he heard on the cornet. Because in those days, the cornet had the lead melody in New Orleans music, which was a predominant form of jazz in the time, other than piano, ragtime, and stride. So when he was 17 years old, he left home to take a job. He convinced his family to let him go so he can take a job playing with Louis Depp and his Symphonian Serenaders in a Pittsburgh nightclub called the Leader House. He was paid $15 a week. He got room and board. He got a couple of meals a day. And that was his first professional gig at age 17. I mean, it was incredible to leave home and go and play a gig like that. And Depp was a well-known singer, and he sang classical and popular songs. And he took Earl to all his gigs, and he used him as an accompanist. And if I'm not mistaken, I believe he used them for some of the classical stuff that he was doing as well. And in 1921, Hines and Depp became the first African Americans to perform on radio. This is really cool. Depp and Hines appeared as a duet on KDKA AM radio in 1921. They were the first African-American performers ever to appear on radio, and the broadcast was played over a loudspeaker on Wiley Avenue. Crowds mobbed the street to listen and then stayed to cheer Depp and Hines when they made it back to the hill. So here you see in this picture, on the left, you see Earl Hines, and on the right, you see Louis Depp. And it looks like they're having dinner of some kind. And over here, in this picture, this is Earl Hines at the Leader House in Pittsburgh playing. He had this big upright piano that you can see. So then, after that, they were supposed to record Louis Depp. And Earl Hines wanted to be signed by OK Records. And OK Records is the record label that put out Louis Armstrong's Hot Fives and Hot Seven recordings. So this was a very popular recording company at the time, and it was a big deal to be with them. So they got written up in the paper because they were going over to New York to see if they can sign with them. Or in this case, they call it register with OK Records. But apparently, OK was not interested. And so then they came home and they didn't have a record label. And they wanted to put out the music that they were working on. So Depp instead did the independent artist thing, which is today is easy. You go on CD Baby and they distribute it for you, or a number of different companies just like that. But back in the day, it was really hard for an artist to independently print records and put out their stuff. So there was this company called Jeanette Records, and what they did, they had these things called Jeanette Specials. And in a Jeanette Special, the artist would pay the record label to record their band. So you pay the record label, they record your band, they would print your record, and then you would be responsible for marketing and sales, and taking every, you took all the risk. But because it was so rare to be a recorded artist, that if you could actually get a record made, it was a big deal, even if it was a Jeanette Special. So here you can see this poster of Depp's Jeanette record is here, a real treat by Pittsburgh's only recording race artists, Congane and Falling. Those are the two songs that they recorded. Congane was in the first one, and Falling was on the second side. And Congane says here, a keen, happy foxtrot composed by Earl Hines. So Louis Depp allowed Earl to feature his own composition. And then he was playing a solo. He played a solo in there. So he was showing that within a group contest, a context, the piano could be a soloist. And then Falling was a special arrangement with solo part by Vance Dixon, director and saxophone virtuoso. I believe Vance Dixon was the director of the band, and the leader was Louis Depp. So this is really cool because it shows here some of the other nationally known race artists that were... that had their own Jeanette records. King Oliver, Jelly Roll Morton. And so it was a big deal to have a record. And these guys made it happen, which I have no idea how Louis Depp had the money to go and pay for all of this. But man, it's, I mean, they were playing every night, 6-7 nights a week, two, three shows a night, and then even 4 shows on the weekends. So let me read you this quote here. Jeanette specials of this type were not listed in the company's catalogs. Recording and reproduction were paid for entirely by the artists, who were responsible for their own marketing and sales. A few specials are known to have been placed in the Star Piano Company's various retail outlets. So you go to the piano store to buy pianos, to listen to new music, to buy music, and they had probably sheet music and records and pianos. And they had people there playing, like real people would sit there and play whatever music was popular the day. So that if they liked it, they would buy the sheet music or the records. But most often they were hawked directly by the artist or were sold by independent dealers, as was the case with Depp. And here in the poster, you can see at the bottom some of these stores: Goldman and Wolf, Arcaro Fono Company, Dorsey Brothers, G.O.M. Wood, Crampton Drug Company, and Hearth Coveric Company. So these are all the different places, different stores where you could go and buy these records. So that's pretty cool. So here, let's listen to this Congane. I don't even know if I'm pronouncing that correctly. It's a composition by Earl Hines, and this was the record that he did with Louis Depp.
Thank you.
How cool is that? Did you hear that solo by Earl Hines? Oh my gosh, that was incredible. Absolutely incredible. Well, it turns out that as you can hear Earl there, he kind of sounds like James P. Johnson a little bit. He sounds he's definitely well versed in the stride piano tradition, but then he had a little extra there with his right hand, which was really cool. Especially, I think what's particularly special about him was his rhythm, the way that he would syncopate. I don't think that was quite done that way in those days, and it was particularly he was good at going against the grain of the rhythm and play rhythmically and keep the whole thing going, you know? So UB Blake, so ragtime pianist UB Blake, he was a stride pianist as well, more than a ragtime pianist, I think. He appeared frequently in Pittsburgh and was a friend of Earl's Aunt Sadie. So UB, how cool is that? That a jazz legend is a good friend of your aunt. So UB heard Earl play at his aunt's house several times. And Blake told Sadie, this boy's a genius. He has no business staying here. On one visit to Aunt Sadie's, Blake advised Earl that if he wanted to make it in show business, he had to leave Pittsburgh. He told Earl, son, you have no business here. You got to leave Pittsburgh. I'm going to take this cane and wear it out all over your head if you're not gone when I come back. The opportunity soon came knocking when Harry Collin, the owner of the Collins Inn, asked Earl if he would play at his new club on State Street in Chicago. That club was called Elite Number 2. And so that's what happened. He left Pittsburgh, and he left Louis Depp, and he went to Chicago. So the birthplace of jazz is New Orleans, and that's where Jelly Roll Morton, King Oliver, and Louis Armstrong all came to be, and they were doing their music there. And then King Oliver moved to Chicago, and then Louis Armstrong followed him to Chicago. I guess Jelly Roll Morton at some point went to Chicago as well. So by this time, by the mid-20s, Chicago was the place for jazz. This was the new hub of jazz. It was where jazz was starting to grow up, you know? If it was born in New Orleans, it grew up in Chicago. And when Earl Hines moved to Chicago, he was playing at this Elite Number 2 club, and it was an after hours club. It was open from midnight to 6 a.m. and word spread quickly about Earl Hines and his playing and his trumpet style and his syncopation and how good he was. And so Jelly Roll and Teddy Weatherford, Carol Dickerson, and other prominent musicians of the era came out to see him, to hear him play. And Hines joined Carol Dickerson's band. And this band is particularly interesting because they were part of the Pantages theater circuit. This guy named Alexander Pantages had built a theater circuit spanning from Winnipeg all the way to California and through the United States. And so so Earl, right after moving to Chicago, was playing at this club and then gets picked up by Carol Dickerson, and he goes on this 42-week national tour on the Pantages theater circuit in 1926 that took them all the way to California and back. And so here you can see one of those theaters. This is the Pantages Playhouse that was built in 1914. This is the starting point of the Pantages circuit in the city of Winnipeg, Manitoba. So you can see, you'll find that there are Pantages theaters all through the United States. It's pretty interesting. So this is a picture of the Carol Dickerson Band. Later in 1928, Louis Armstrong had joined the band as well. And in the back on the piano, you see Earl Hines. Next to him on the violin is Carol Dickerson. And then you can see Louis over here in the front. And you can see the band. You had the reed players, you had a banjo player. So at this point, you're still in that early jazz instrumentation and vibe and thing going on. Trombone, trumpet, and you had tenor, soprano, and some clarinet over there. So is a tuba. So it's really interesting the way that this was happening. There was a lot of music and people went out dancing and they played all night long. I have no idea how they survived like that. Sleeping during the day, working all night. It's crazy. So Satchmo and Earl. So as you are probably familiar with, Earl Hines met Louis Armstrong in Chicago. And that's where they became friends. And that's how Earl got involved with Louis' project. He had a recording band called the Hot Fives. And when he added the tuba and something else, it was the Hot Sevens. And so Earl replaced Little Hardin, which was Louis Armstrong's wife. And the recordings that they made are considered to be some of the greatest jazz recordings ever made, and it was laid the foundation for what jazz could be. So Hines met Louis Armstrong in the pool room of the Black Musicians Union, the local 208 on State and 39th Street in Chicago. Hines was 21, Armstrong was 24, and Louis was impressed by Hines' trumpet style of piano playing, often using fast octaves so that he could be heard over the bands. You got to think, at this time, you see all those instruments over here in the piano. The piano did not have any amplification. And very often, it wasn't a grand piano. Very often, he had an upright. So the amount of sound that he could produce was limited. So you can hear, you can see how he took off the front and he would try to, so they had to play loud and he would be covered up easily by all those horns. So he would play an octaves and do his soloing in octaves, and they were, you know, you're soloing, so it's fast, and he did that so he could be heard over the band, and that's how he developed his style out of necessity. So Armstrong and Hines became good friends. Louis joined Hines and Carol Dickerson's band at the Sunset Cafe in 1927, this became Armstrong's band under the musical direction of Hines. Later that year, Armstrong revamped his OK Records recording-only band, the Hot Fives and Sevens, and hired Hines to be the pianist, replacing Little Hardin. Now, Armstrong and Hines then recorded what are often regarded as some of the most important jazz records ever made. And here's an example of this. This is called Weather. Thank you. Is that not heaven or what? Oh my gosh, that is lovely. So that is Weatherbird. What's incredible about this is it's just the two of them, and they combine their unique styles in an incredible way. The way that they play off of each other is just absolutely marvelous. It shows the best of each other's playing, and they play so well together. Okay, so let me tell you the story that I found about how the nickname Father was born. I don't know if this is true, but this is the way it goes. Beginning in 1934, so this is past the hot fives and sevens. We're now in the 1930s. This is the big band era, right? And he has his own band, and he's touring all over the place and trying to stay busy and doing radio. And he's one of the most popular people of the time because those hot five and seven recordings really took off. So beginning in 1934, the Hines Orchestra was broadcast live on national radio from the Grand Terrace for many years, sometimes even nights a week, seven nights a week. They became the most broadcast band in America. Hines was christened with the nickname of Father by the MC of his radio show. Before the show, the MC was found passed out drunk on a table. Earl lectured the MC about his drinking. At the start of the show, the angry announcer, stinging from Earl's fatherly advice, introduced Earl and his band, saying, "Here comes Father Hines out of the forest with his children." Earl hated the nickname Father, but it stuck. Music historians say that Father is an apt name, as Earl Hines is one of the fathers of jazz, and that he is indeed. I mean, the influence that he had is incredible. I wanted to show you one thing. I remember hearing an interview, and somebody said, "Oh, you know, people do this little shake on the piano, the tremolo, you know." Well, you know, that's a Herbie thing. Don't do that. Herbie was doing it because he couldn't play long notes, so he did it. Well, if you catch here, you can see Earl Hines doing it about a million years before Herbie. Right there. Did you hear that? The Herbie Shake, done in 1927 by Earl Hines. So nothing is original, nothing is new. Everyone is, we're all just doing our own versions of what has already come before us, I believe. Okay, so then that's how he got his nickname Father. The birth of bebop. So one of the hardest things I had was deciding where to stop, how much of Earl Hines to talk about. And so I stopped here at this era because this is, I think, the most important part of this situation. So he is one of the most popular musicians of his time. He's touring nonstop. He's on the radio. He was in the most admired recording of the time. He's one of the first one of the first African Americans to be on the radio, if not the first. He's a composer. He's recorded. The accolades are stacking up, right? And you get to the World War II, and the war is happening, and then the American Federation of Musicians had a strike because there's disagreement over royalty payments. Also, I believe a lot of materials are being used for the war, so you couldn't make records on on certain materials, and it was hard to get materials and stuff. So it was a hard time to record during this time. And some of this that I'm going to talk about was sadly not able to be preserved or recorded. And this would have been the origins of the bebop movement. I don't think we had a recording until 1945 or 1946 of Charlie Parker. But the birth of bebop wasn't this singular thing. It was this thing that's molding over time from the late 1930s all the way to the mid 1940s. It was little by little becoming what it was going to be. So in 1942, Earl Hines had Charlie Parker and Dizzy Gillespie in his band. Okay? So Earl Hines was the connector. He connected these people together. He created the space for bebop to happen, for the next thing to happen. Modern jazz piano is based on Earl Hines playing, on saying, hey, we can solo on the piano inside of a band and not just by yourself. And in the way that he played rhythmically, and how, what an incredible pianist he was. And so you have this, he's a band leader, he's a composer, and he's making really good money. He saved a lot of money at this point, and it's a big deal to be in Earl Hines' band. And so he gets, so Charlie Parker and Dizzy get this big break, and they're in Earl Hines' band. And despite wartime difficulties, Hines took this, his bands, on tour from coast to coast. So they're traveling, they're playing every night, constantly hanging out. I believe Charlie Parker was only in the band for a year. He got fired for being late, despite trying to sleep on the bandstand so that he could be there when it was time to play. But bebop was born in the late night jam sessions with the members of Hines' band after the night was, after their concert was over. So they're touring, they had a concert, and then they hosted these late night jam sessions. And that sowed the seeds for the emerging new style in jazz called bebop. In August 1st, 1942, the American Federation of Musicians began a strike against the major American record companies because of disagreements over royalty payments. So beginning at midnight on July 31st in 1942, no union musician could make commercial recordings for any commercial record company. That meant that a union musician was allowed to participate on radio programs and other kinds of musical entertainment, but not in a recording session. The 1942 to 1944 musicians strike remains the longest strike in entertainment history. I don't know if that's true today, but that's pretty interesting. I found this picture. I think this is later on. There's Sarah Vaughan is at the piano. Billy Eckstine is singing. Earl Hines is standing behind him, and this guy all the way to the right, do you recognize him? That's Charlie Parker. And that is the beginning of the rest of jazz. And it was all made possible because of Earl Hines and his success and his ability to navigate all the changes. He was in there at the beginning of jazz, learned stride and ragtime. It was not some of his favorite music, but he played it anyways. And then he learned how to play the piano, and then he was learning how to play jazz, and he was there from the very, very beginning before it was even called jazz. So this video is a little lengthy, but it's super, super important. He's talking about he's showing examples of everything I'm talking about, his styles, how he changed, what is the trumpet style of playing of Earl Hines, and hearing him talk and play is absolutely marvelous. So I'll play you a little bit of this clip here.
Days of jazz piano. Show us some of the things that have influenced him down through his career as he developed as a jazz musician, and bring the piano up to date. And one of the things that I want to point out here, because Earl is really too modest to do this, is that he's always remained very interested in every aspect of jazz music, listening to new players and having them with him in his bands from time to time. He's accompanied by Earl Watkins on drums and Johnny Green on bass and Earl Father Hines on piano.
Light touch of what they used to do years ago called ragtime. Of course, I can't actually go through it as much as I heard because I just didn't care for that particular style. I was playing classic at that time. But that was what they call a single bass. And that's all you had, just a single bass on it. And then later on, as I began to get into jazz, I ran across a couple of fellas that were working in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. And as I happened to mention just a few moments ago that I was getting $12 a week. So I ran across one fellow that had a terrific left hand. And later on in the mornings, I used to sit and listen to this fellow. And he would play, and it sounded so much like an organ, I didn't think a person could get that much out of piano. But tense meant that that's the first, that's the bass, that's the third, that's the fifth, and as you stretch, that's 10. They call that tense. And here's the way he used to play his left hand. That's pretty, that's what happened during those days. And of course, in order for me to interest this fellow, because he didn't know anything about me, why, he had a habit of particular beer, which I will not call the title of a beer, but anyway, and tobacco. And so I used to spend my little change and buy him that. And then I ran across another fellow that had a terrific right hand. His name was Johnny Waters. He was doing the same thing in the right hand. He was carrying a melody. In the right hand, and he used to like a certain type of gin and some Camel cigarettes. So I split my salaries up between those two fellows. And with what I had learned as far as classics were concerned, it came out something like this. Well, then we used to play dances by myself. In fact, I played a whole dance. They used to come to me with club organizations, what have you, and say, do you want to play a dance? I said, sure. Well, during those days, we didn't have a musicians' union. And the only way the musicians used to get work was because we'd go home in the evening and dress up and stand on the street. And people used to pick us up off the street. Is the piano player here? Is the drummer here? Well, of course, we were always dressed, you know. So I'd go out and play a dance. I'd play from 9 to 1, whatever price that I thought I was worth is what I got. Because if they didn't like what I did, I wasn't hired again. But anyway, we started to playing that way around the little neighborhood towns. And I began to get what you call a little strong because I had gained quite a bit of experience playing piano by myself. Then I heard such things as a drummer coming around, you know what I mean? So I said, well, now that should add to the rhythm section. So we had the drums added to it, and of course Earl Watson's going to demonstrate in a few moments, and then came the bass horn, which later on turned into a bass fiddle. And so we used to try to swing a lot of things. And I used to play like this. When I joined the bands, then they said, Earl, you got to slow your music down in order to play with an organization. So I heard a little fellow playing a tune one time in a club called Leader House, and the tune was called Squeeze Me, something like this. Later on, I got into the bands, and I found out that the band was so large and playing single like that, why I couldn't be heard. So I brought to prominence a little thing called trumpet style, which meant I played octaves so I could be heard through this big band, something like this. Like this, that was when you used to hold a high note, you know, on the trumpet. Well, I didn't have the trumpet, so that's where I used the tremolo from, you see. So now let's bring in the drums. And during those years,
is that not absolutely incredible? And there's the tremolo thing I was talking about, the Herbie Shake, right there, the real inventor of the Herbie Shake. And he did this thing at the end where he did a glissando with his both. With two fingers, it goes, I have no idea how that works. I've tried to do a glissando, and you know, you use your nail, and so you kind of go down with the piano with one, but he was able to do it with two fingers. No idea. It sounded amazing. This guy is incredible beyond words, and it's been absolutely fascinating to learn about him and about his music and everything that he was a part of. So thank you so much for listening to my What I Love About Earl Hines.
Wow, thank you so much, John. What a wealth of information that you have shared with us today. We really appreciate the research you've done. Oh, Father, make sure I say that. Father, Earl Hines, I can hear someone saying that now. I know we have a couple of questions here. I noticed that you did give us a snapshot of the early stages of the music industry. You mentioned that the musicians were responsible for doing their own promotion, trying to get their recordings done and things of that sort. And they even pretty much almost, I guess we're looking at payola in the beginning, right? Where they have to pretty much get out there and pay to play. So was that for mostly just jazz musicians, or, you know, I mean, was it just that genre that had to promote themselves like that, or was it for most genres during that time?
I don't know. To be honest with you, I really don't know. What I remember reading was that this was a specific type of deal with Jeanette. It's called the Jeanette Special, where you went the independent artist route. That was just one of the options that you had. If you had the money, you could pay to have your record recorded and printed, and you would pay for all of that. But, you know, I think traditionally, the company would take all those risks and pay you a little bit, you know, probably not a lot. I believe that Louis Depp's record actually did very well in Pittsburgh and in the Pennsylvania Pittsburgh area. So I don't know. I don't know if he got his initial investment back or how well the record did. But I think this was not. This was, there were, you know, you had to be either signed by a label or go independent. And I don't know the percentages of how often musicians paid for their own record to be recorded and printed, and how often they were signed by the record label to do that. That's a great question.
Awesome. Awesome. I also appreciated how you told us about the journey from, say, New Orleans to Chicago. We always hear about Kansas City, how you had to go to a certain area to be recognized. And how do you think that plays similar to today? Do you think that's still alive, far as you have to be in a certain area? Or is it because of technology, you can be anywhere and be popular in the genre?
Yeah. I think they're both true. Personally, if you live in New York and you're, if you play well and you're involved in the jazz community there, you're going to have opportunities that you won't have in, I don't know, Ocala, for example. You know, it's just the way it is. That's where the people are, the movers and the shakers and the money. That's where the money is. Follow the money, you know? And so definitely, it makes a big difference if you live in a town where lots of big touring artists live and play locally. And then they see you play and they like you and they pick you up and then, you know, you're with them. So that's why people live in LA and New York and in Nashville, because a lot of people who have influence within the music industry live in those places. At the same time, the internet has vastly eaten up at the gatekeeper's ability to decide who gets to be in the club and who's not. And so if you are good at marketing and promoting yourself, and you're also good at performing, you can definitely become an internet famous person. I mean, the internet is full of like internet famous pianists and you know, musicians who haven't, you know, had the opportunity to play on the big stage with the big artists, but because they're very popular online, it certainly gives them a hand it gives them ability to make a living and doing their thing and be more widely recognized. And, you know, actually to date, the most popular artists are people who have made it within the industry and have also developed a large fan base on the internet. I think one of the best people at using the internet to connect with their audience is the young singer guy that plays the piano. I can't think his name. Michael, can you help me out? He overdubs himself singing, and he's super, super popular with the kids these days.
There's so many of them right now.
Jacob Collier.
That's right.
Absolutely excellent at putting online content. And he shares his music. He has these sessions where he shares his Logic Pro sessions and what's happening there. And then he's super goofy and himself. And I think, you know, that goes a long way as well.
Okay. So the last thing, and I know we're about to wrap up, I noticed you said that he wasn't a huge fan of, say, the New Orleans style music, or, you know, he was playing with Armstrong.
He was a huge fan of ragtime.
Ragtime.
So ragtime came, you know, way before, in the late 1890s, early 1890s, with Scott Joplin and different guys who were writing ragtime music. And so, I mean, you can tell from his playing that he knows how to play stride piano, right? Which is just like a derivative of ragtime, very similar, different language of improvisation, of putting things together, but very similar in the way it's constructed. But so I would say just ragtime. Like, he probably would not sit down and play you the Maple Leaf Rag, but I bet you he knew, you know, Carolina Shout by James B. Johnson, for example.
Okay. What an amazing journey you had to even experience that and bebop and playing so many artists and experiencing those different changes in the genre of jazz that we love. So yeah. I can only imagine the experiences Father Earl Hines had. That is amazing. So we always hear the bigger names. We don't know the guys in the background that really made them shine even more. So thank you so much for sharing this information on Father Earl Hines. And I just want to remind everyone that, guess what? If you really enjoyed this, we have one more session this week. That's going to be tomorrow at 4:30. We have Alejandro.
Hey. Yes,
I think you know that name. Yeah, and he's going to say what I love about Oscar Pettiford. So you know that's going to be an exciting session. So please, please, please join us tomorrow for that session. And we want to thank everyone for coming out. And we will see you tomorrow. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much for having me. And thank you for hosting. This was great. Thank you.
Great. We'll see you next time. Thank you. And if you want to check out any of our past sessions, don't forget, you can always go back to our website and go to Clearwater Jazz and check out those sessions and share them and bring more people next time so they can get this wealth of information. Whether you're a student or you're an expert musician, we would love more feedback, and we want to make this even bigger and better. So thank you so much for joining us. Thank you again, John, and all of our sponsors. Have a great day.
Thank you. Have a great day.